Is that okay to? Okay. Anyway, I'm not so sure if it's good or not to be the first one. A bit excited. Anyway, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you all the organization who organized the Global Award for Sustainable Architecture. And it's my honor to be here and share with you my work. So I will start now. So sorry that I have to talk in English. English is difficult enough, so sorry about this. Okay, I've been working with the poor for quite a long time. So as you can see from the slides, from the screen, these are the image that you can see, usually you can see in a slum, if you go to a slum in a developing country. And these are some of the places that I work with. So you consider these people are poor. I'm not so sure, but yes, definitely they are poor. But what I'm going to talk today is about how I work with the poor, and maybe later we can think about the definition of the poor again. So this is the smallest house I have ever seen in my life. First, I thought that might be in Thailand, some kind of, you know, 2 by 2 meter can be the smallest. But this house beat the record. It's a house. I took this photo in Phnom Penh, the capital of Cambodia. And in the beginning, I thought it's just, you know, it's a room for a man or a member of family just attached to another house. But it's actually, it's a house. Someone said to me, like, this is a house of a man who work like a daily work in Phnom Penh. And this house was located on the rooftop of the cinema, a former, you know, theater in Phnom Penh. But there's no longer theater anymore. Just the people invade the rooftop and build their own houses. And this is the smallest one I have ever seen. And if you can see that it's against all the, you know, the thing that you learn in architecture school. I mean, if I submit this to my professor, I will get F, something like this, you know. But for me, I was so amazed, you know, how their house, he housed himself by using, you know, whatever materials that he can find. And this house is free. I mean, costs nothing. And this is what I see all the time. This is also another example of how the city changed and this effect the people who live in such a place like this. You can see these rundown houses. It was a wealthy house before, but because of the city change, the transport system change, so this house just, it's located along a canal in Bangkok. In the past, we used canal a lot as a main, you know, transport, way. But now we changed to use car, and we use the road system. So the canal become less used as a transportation, so that affect the city quite a lot. So this house was kind of left empty and nobody used. So the poor just invade and use this as a house. And you can see that it was not a slum, but now become slum. This is also another kind of slum that you can see a lot in the world. On top is a slum underneath the expressway in Bangkok. This is in the heart of Bangkok. So what I see, this is, I mean, every time when I see this, I was so amazed at how people can, you know, house themselves and using all kind of things you can find in the street to make a house. So the house depends on the height of the highway of the expressway. So this group of houses along and underneath the expressway in this area can be from one story up to three or four stories, depending on the height of the highway. And I was so impressed about this, and I found that This is amazing, you know, how you can just build your own house. You know, you this is not so good. If they say this, sometimes they said, some people said that you encourage people to invade public land. But this is no choice, you know, they have to work there, and then they are part of the city, and they have function in the city, big city like Bangkok. The bottom picture I took in Mumbai in India, the houses were built on the footpath in Mumbai. So can you imagine it's quite narrow, it's quite, you know, very shallow. It's just less than 2 meter width like that. Very, very, very small, but they managed to stay and then to live in. And both pictures got electricity connected. So in terms of, you know, how they relate to the neighbor, it's amazing that how they can connect the electricity, something like this. So what I see is not just a house that they built, you know, that they built a kind of relationship in the area as well. This is also another example of the slum in Bangkok. It was a kind of a wealthy, a very busy market before, but now when the city changed, this become a kind of rundown area and become slums. This is another example. I mean, from this, maybe we can move to another subject, otherwise it's going to be, you know, showing you all the slum. But because I've been working with the poor for quite a long time, and I see this kind of working with the limitation is very interesting. Because with the limitation, I can see that limitation can create, you know, some kind of new idea. People who live in a limitation, you know whether in terms of financial or social or whatever, they struggle a lot, you know, with this. And many times they come up with a very good idea, and it's free. It's very amazing. This house was taken in Osaka in Japan a long time ago, when there was the first crisis, economic crisis, a long time ago, more than 10 years ago, Tom Yam Kung crisis. And I went there and see this house. My friend took me to this place, and I saw this and I was so impressed about this. And the guy who owned this house, he was also so surprised that why so many people visited his house. Because in this area, it is near the station, near Shin Osaka station, the train station. And the people who are homeless and live in this area, usually they got a van, you know, a car, and they live in the van. But this guy doesn't have a van, so he built his own house out of cans, soda cans and beer cans, something like that. So I was very surprised, and, you know, because he's Japanese, so all the details are so neat. So I talked with my friend. I said, oh, this is so good. And the guy was still so, you know, surprised. Why are you looking at, you know, this is so poor? And my friend said the municipality want to, you know, remove this house because it's just built on the footpath and it's illegal anyway. So I took this photo because I think by that time, I think that if I show this photo to the people that I work with in Thailand, that might inspire them, you know, to think of some kind of housing, new way of using something to build a house. So I show them this photo, and they look at this photo like a very carefully, you know, look so excited. And I ask, well, how is it? And they say like, well, you know, you can sell this, you can earn a lot of money from this, you know, selling cans and bottles. So they didn't care about the design and, you know, the house, but they see this as an asset that you can earn money. So I showed to some of my friends who are, you know, in this kind of architecture or no, a bit of, you know, better off. And they look at this like, oh, this is rubbish, you know, this is rubbish, this is not good. But the interesting thing is that I went there again later, and the house wasn't there. So I asked my friend, what happened to the house? And he said, well, I asked the municipality, just, you know, evict him or what? He said, no, it's in an art gallery. I said, what? He said, yeah, it's moved to an art gallery. I asked, what about the guy, the old guy? He said, he also worked in an art gallery as an artist. So I was very surprised. But this is a story, not a story, this is a real story that, you know, I would like you to know. Because every time when we work in a community, what you see and what other people see are not the same thing. You know, we see things differently. So when you work with people, you don't know what they think. That's a thing. You don't know what they think. You cannot say that this is a house. For some people, yes, this is a house. For some people, this is rubbish. For some people, yes, this is money. And for some people, this is a piece of art. That kind of thing. So every time when I work with students, I always encourage them to think, you know, in other ways. Try to understand. But you will never understand. You have to understand that you will never understand anyway. And this is another example in Thailand also. This is a house they just built on a canal. And now there's a problem because with the present government, he wants to evict all the community along the canal, you know, to move out from there. This is another place that, actually this is not really a slum, but this is a slum, but it has been removed to some place already. So this is a kind of rebuilt at a new place. So in order to understand what the people think, in order to answer the question, because what I found in working with the people is that if you make a program or if you do something for them, it's not working very well. It's like you don't know what they think, what they need. So in order to understand, or in order to get the correct information, in order to create a correct program, in order to design a good architecture with them, you need to understand and to collect all the, how to call that, correct information, the right information. So how to get the right information? I usually work with the people from the beginning. So the architectural design process, or even not only the architectural design process, but from the beginning of collecting information, I always work with the people. And I found that the best way to do is to work with the children. All the time I work with the children. Many times when I enter the community, a poor community, adults, you know, grown-ups always hesitate to talk with me or not so trust or, you know, don't believe what we are doing and what are you doing here. So I think working with the children is the best way to start the work, because every time when you work with children, the parents also come to you and ask, what are you doing here? Are you selling drugs or something to my children? And I found that working with children, you get all kind of information, not just, you know, physical information. You got all kind of social information, financial information, all kind of, you know, information. For example, this map, this is a community map, and it's the best that I have ever done. And it's done, all done by children, very detailed. So I just paint. It's this community located along canal, along two canals. And I just painted a canal and asked the children to build their own homes and put on the site. So they put all the houses on along the canal and put all the trees also very accurate, you know, position or kind of thing. And what I have from these, not just a community map, you know, with this I learn a lot, because after they finished the mapping, this model map, I found that there are so many accesses to this community. Because in the beginning I thought that just, you know, to enter this community, just there's one way to go to this community. But after this I found that there are so many, you know, entrances. Like, okay, in case of you go to school late, you use this way, you know. If you come from school and you don't want to go directly to your house, you go this way, something like this. And even know that, you know, which house got a problem, or kind of thing. Very, very funny and very fun. And then after that, we continue, and then the adult will join. This is also another kind of, you know, working with people. This is some part of, you know, it's a kind of, this is a relocation project. And I work with the people along the Rama Tree in Bangkok, is in the center, and the land price is very, very high. So the land that we proposed to the government is very small. It's like only like a 23, 24 acres for 780 families. So it's quite small. So I see, and I understand at the beginning that it's impossible to build a detached house. But you know, people in a slum, usually they used to live in a house, you know, attached to the ground. They don't like living in a high rise, something like this, because of their career, their job, something. So I just kind of creating activity so we can learn together. It's kind of learning together that why. I want to understand also that why they don't want to go up. And I want also them to learn about how we can, you know, create a house. So this is a kind of almost in the middle of the process that the people started to understand that to have such a small plot of land is impossible to build a detached houses for everyone. But they started to understand that, okay, we have to live in a block of flat or whatever, but how? That's the beginning of designing a flat for low-income people in this area. And without any arguing, without any fighting, it's quite fun. So we understand a lot as well about what they think, that why they don't want to move up. Because actually there's a kind of a new development plan done by a company that's hired by the government to study all the whole area. And this company proposed like many, you know, condominium types of accommodation. And then they opened to public to ask, you know, to see the idea. And I found that it's very interesting because in that area, the people started to ask questions that the architect couldn't answer. And I feel so sorry for them. Because when the people see the high rise and they just ask, so we have to move to that big building? And the architect said, yes, you will move to, you know, nicer building with a lift. You have to walk upstairs, you know, you got an elevator. She said, well, okay, but can I still sell barbecue chicken? And the architect was quite, what? She said, can I still, you know, sell barbecue chicken? I heard that there's something that if you make a smoke, they will, you know, cry, shout out loud that smoke, 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 like this. So if I still selling chicken, so I cannot live up there because the smoke detector will, you know, activate all the time. something like this. And also another thing about question from the people, very interesting is that, you know, in Thailand, we are Buddhist, you know, most are Buddhist, and they're quite attached to this Buddhist activity. So every morning, sometimes we offer food for monk. So the monk will move around, and then the people will offer food for the monk. So one old lady raised her hand, like, what about if I want to offer the food for the monk every morning? I have to come down, or the monk will come up. And I was so like so lucky that I wasn't an architect there, you know. I just observed. And the architect, I feel so sorry for him. And he couldn't answer the question. He was like, we don't know. Maybe the monk want to come up or you come down, whatever. So this is a kind of example that I found in the work. So I think it's better work with the people, talk with them and see what they like and what they think and what is the real problem. I found all the time when I got a student working with me, especially, you know, postgraduate student, you know, master degree, PhD or whatever, they come as an expert in the community. Look, you got a very poor house, you should move, you know, repair your roof, you know, fix this and fix that. And people always said, no, that's not a priority. We need to feed our children first. Housing is not priority. So as an architect, I don't know what to do with this. And the students always said, look, I don't think that they need architects. I don't think they need architects. I said, yes, they need architects. They always need architects, but they don't know. And you don't know. If you work like this, you don't know. So they need architects. So let's do it. And then you will see something like this. So this has happened all the time. I use aerial photographs sometimes as well, just to get attention. This is a community in the south of Thailand. This is one of the most difficult community I have done. It took me 3 years there, and it's not quite finished. So the first 6 months, just walking in the community, say hello, hello, like this. And everyone will ask, what are you doing here? What are you doing here? And that's the work. So I sit, have coffee, and then talk with them, and then they start conversation for 6 months, drinking coffee. 6 months drinking coffee, walking around, like this. So the sponsor sometimes didn't understand, what are you doing with my money? 6 months drinking coffee. So, but I found that walking 6 months in this community, you know, tell me a lot of things. I found that this community is like a small country. It is, you know, full of classes, you know. You got the poor, very poor poor, very middle class poor, middle poor, super rich, you know, rich poor, super rich poor, something like this, so many classes. So after 6 months, I decided to work with the grassroots in the grassroots community. So working in a community already, you know, working with the grassroots. But with this community, you need to work with the grassroots in the grassroots community. So make it more difficult. So all kind of thing. And it's a mixed, you know, Buddhist and Muslim community as well. So the first one, the first 6 months I was kind of drinking coffee, and then later doing all kind of mapping the community. Not just you know, physical map, but also everything, the play area, you know, drainage, materials, religion map, playing, happiness, whatever that you can think of the map, not just physical. And then we just discuss on that. This is another kind of model that we do all the time. So it's a one-to-one scale. It's the the one-to-one scale of model. This is also part of the process, because as you know that I work with the limit, I mean with the poor who has such a limitation in everything, and also I have that kind of financial limitation as well. So everyone, you need to make it very useful. So this is a model that we did with the people. This is to encourage them to how to get more confidence, and also this is a kind of propaganda to the other organization in Thailand. This is also some part. So you can see, we work with all kind of, you know, activities, making tools, and you know, try to understand, and then we decide together, and then solve the problem together. This is also some part. Now I work with students. I work with students a lot. So we have like a kind of summer course when they have like a summer holiday. So we work in a community together. Very simple, so can do everything with the community. And this is some kind of example when we work in a community. Sometimes you don't touch the house. This community, we just build the walkway, the footpath together. And then you can see that it's changed a lot because of you grow you build the footpath, but also you build the confidence, you know, of the people as well in order to improve their own living condition. So finally, from the footpath, they improve their own houses. This is also some part of the houses that, you know, finally they built after working together. This is also another relocation project in the south that we work with the community, with the slum community, and we move to the new site. So this is how we work now with the students. So we got a warehouse full of all kind of, you know, leftover material, rubbish, and all kind of thing. And students can look at this and decide what they can do with all kind of leftover or rubbish or garbage, you know, recycle thing as a building materials. And we work with the kids and people in a community. This is another thing that interests me a lot is this is a slum in Osaka. I took from the photo that my friends showed me. And I was very surprised that it's exactly the same as slum in Thailand, but no more slum like this in Japan. This is the first public housing, I think the first public housing in Osaka. And I was very surprised at that time I visited, like 10 years ago. This was about to knock down, to rebuild a new one. And I thought that this is so good, you know, much better condition than some building in Thailand and also in Cambodia, even worse condition. So this is the first public housing in Osaka. And this is also the public housing in Osaka, near Shin-Osaka Station. And it looks so good. It looks so good. And this is a part of the homeless area in Japan as well. This is a shelter that done by NGO and government, you know, to put the homeless in here. This is a house in housing in Hong Kong. Yeah. What I try to talk is so like this is a house in housing in Hong Kong. In Hong Kong, again, some part like this in Thailand as well. Now we started to have this kind of houses for middle class. So I think, who is the poor then? Because I have done a lot of housing for poor people, very poor people. But what about us? I don't have a house. I live with my mom. Many people just rent an apartment, you know. So I started to think about this and start to work on a pilot project, a kind of experimental project called Ten House, using the same way as, you know, working with the poor people. So we started by talking together where you want to stay, how, you know, what type of the house and how we can live together. And then we put the design together. And this is how we work, you know, through the designing process. And then we built it ourselves because it's too expensive if you hire a contractor, So we decided to build it ourselves. So we form a group of builders and thing, and then we do it. And when it's finished, it's like this. So it's very cheap compared to the market price. So it costs very, like almost half price of the market price. So it's been, I mean, it's proof that this is possible if we work together and do something. And this is the house. Very, I mean, each house got a very different style depending on the owner. But this make me think about middle class, who is not the poor. But I don't know about in France, but in developing country, like in Thailand, I found that the middle class is quite poor, you know? When you are poor, you live in a slum, you are fine. You got access to so many, you know, aids or funding or government program. When you are rich, that's fine. You can take care of everything, whatever. And what about the middle class? Because from the project that I did, the 10 house, I found that too stuck in the middle. You cannot do much. I asked, when we decide the house, we asked for the loan from the bank. They said, no, you are not qualified, you know, to get a loan. But when I asked the loan from government organization who provide, you know, housing loan to the poor. And they said, no, you're not poor. You're not poor, so you're not qualified to get the fund, the cheap loan for the poor. So for me, I think this is a kind of informal poor for me. And nobody, not many people think about this. So for the last 10 years, I started to think a lot about the informal poor and try to explore, I mean, some kind of, you know, housing type or activity or project that can serve the informal poor. Not many people understand what I'm doing. Yeah. So, but I will finish with the question. I don't know, because you keep saying like this, so I'm not so sure. Okay, so how many minutes I got? Okay. So I just would like to finish with this question. Who is the poor then? You know, who is the poor then? Because sometimes I work in this field for a long, long time, 20 years. And I have completed so many housing projects for the poor. And then I found that the middle class in the developing country is also very poor. Very, very poor. So I started to think about this and try to, you know, experiment, try to explore some kind of, I don't know, project to see what we can do about this. I think that's it for the work that I would like to share with you and hope you enjoy and understand what I try to say. Is that okay? Okay, thank you very much.